in the past. The Senate has not passed. It's on the verge, but it hasn't passed a resolution that allows for the committees of the Senate to organize. Thus, the committee has no official chairman at the moment, with the retirement of Senator Pat Roberts in 2020, who did an excellent job and we will miss. You will see that neither us or Senator Stabenow are sitting in the chairman's seat. We hold this hearing as equal partners today. Senator Stabenow, though, and I have agreed that this is an important hearing today, so that we need to get moving so that we can get the secretary confirmed quickly to address the pressing matters of sending economic relief to those affected by the ongoing pandemic. This hearing shall not create any precedent as to how hearings or markups shall be announced and held when the chairman or ranking member are not officially appointed by the Senate. Senator Stabenow will share in the responsibilities of holding this hearing today and later to consider the nomination with a vote by the committee. It's my understanding that you have agreed to return to the committee in 4 to 6 weeks after arriving at the department to give us more time to discuss your priorities and early activities, since we're moving your nomination today very quickly. We look forward to that discussion. With that explanation, Mr. Secretary, I welcome you to the committee. And I would note that the committee has received a number of letters in support of your nomination and ask consent to include these letters of support into the hearing. So I assume that's without objection. Thank you. During your tenure as President Obama's Secretary of Agriculture, the state of agriculture was affected by a number of issues and events. These included the Great Recession, which left far too many of our fellow Americans hungry and in need of USDA food assistance. A U.S. economy where agriculture was one of the only bright spots, with strong prices and exports and implementation of the 2008-2014 farm bills. As your second term came to a close, however, the ag economy started to dip, which has led to 7 years of depressed prices and difficult times in farm country. And today, we find many more Americans experiencing hunger from the effects of the pandemic. I was grateful that Congress and the department responded to these situations with trade mitigation assistance, disaster assistance, pandemic assistance programs. Without it, I fear we would have seen even more farm bankruptcies and leading to less available food for our nation and the world. I'm a strong believer that past performance is indicative of future performance, Mr. Secretary, and I know you will work with us as you did during your previous tenure. As everyone in this room knows, agriculture is not partisan, but there are regional differences. I was pleased to see that in your previous tenure, you took the time to learn about and understand Southern agriculture. I hope that if you are confirmed, you will continue the same attitude without the various regions and commodities in our country. With that said, I would like to raise a few issues that need to be addressed by the incoming Secretary of Agriculture. I'm concerned with some ideas being discussed in the environmental space. If confirmed, I would expect you to work with your colleagues at EPA to educate them on the strides that production agriculture has already taken to be more efficient and environmentally friendly. As we all know, agriculture ought to be part of the solution, not considered the problem. The President has announced climate change policy will be a priority for the administration. It's important that USDA and this committee keep producers at the forefront of any discussion on climate change. Heavy-handed, one-size-fits-all regulations simply will not work. Just as in a farm bill debate, this issue must be addressed in a fashion that will truly benefit all farmers across the country without mandating specific farming practices. In Arkansas, our farmers have been conserving water by implementing innovative irrigation techniques, converting to surface water irrigation rather than pumping groundwater from the aquifer. Farmers have also improved soil health with cover cropping and minimum tillage, while our ranchers have taken on rotational grazing. These efforts should not be ignored during the policy debate on climate change. Trade is another active issue where your strong voice is needed. I urge you to play an active role in any trade discussions. American agriculture has borne the brunt of trade disputes in the past few years. Prior to that, our farmers and ranchers were competing with foreign governments that did not play by the rules then and that often do not play by the rules today. Our producers need new markets with more market access, and I hope you will continue to be an advocate in this area. We are all aware of the impacts the COVID-19 pandemic has had on our society. We learned our supply chain is more fragile and resilient than we thought. The supply chain didn't break, but the marketplace was certainly very challenging. We need to consider options to make the supply chain even more resilient. In the future, we need to have the ability to respond to these types of black swan events. Unfortunately, we must assume that it is not a question of if another pandemic will occur, but rather when. With the latest package of COVID relief signed into law in December, it is imperative that CPAP assistance gets to those most in need. The Biden administration has announced a 60-day review of some of this assistance while advocating for an additional $1.9 trillion to be passed by Congress. It seems to me that if time is of the essence and the department should move swiftly to deliver that much-needed assistance that has already been provided. I encourage you to carry out this review quickly, consistent with the clear direction in the law. It is imperative to deliver this assistance as those who are struggling this pandemic are well served now instead of later. Again, thank you for joining us today. I look forward to hearing from you and working with you if you confirm. Now I yield to Senator Stabenow for the opening remarks. I had the gavel for a little bit anyway.
I think we each have a gavel today, so
that's big gavel is going to you very shortly.
Well, but I am looking forward. First of all, thank you so much, Senator Bozeman, and I'm looking forward, as I did with Senator Roberts. We really operate as co-chairs in the committee, and I even though the Senate is still finalizing the formal organizing of the committees, as Senator Bozeman indicated, I deeply appreciate your willingness to work together to move forward. We know that we need to put the leadership in place for our farmers, ranchers, families at the USDA. And once again, we're showcasing the Agriculture Committee's strong tradition of bipartisanship. So very much appreciate it. In the coming year, I'm looking forward to learning more about rice and timber and all the wonderful things in Arkansas, in addition to hearing more about the fortunes of your Arkansas Razorbacks. And who knows, maybe my Spartans and your Razorbacks will meet in the NCAA tournament at some point. Who knows? Our strong relationship is really one of the best things about our committee, and it makes it easier to put aside partisan politics and get things done. So, our first job is to consider the nomination, which we are doing today, of former Secretary Tom Vilsack, who is no stranger to the Senate confirmation process or even the role that he's nominated for. Mr. Vilsack, welcome, and thank you for being here virtually today. We appreciate it very much. As the former Agricultural Secretary during all 8 years of the Obama administration, you presided over the USDA with a steady hand and decisive leadership, which we appreciated. As you know, we share a long history together. My last term as chair coincided with your first tenure at the USDA, and I'm so happy we're going to have a chance, if you're confirmed, to be able to work together again. When it comes to food and farm policy, we share many of the same values, from creating a stable, successful agricultural economy to providing food for children and families in need, to making our small towns vibrant places to live, to addressing the climate crisis. Your deep knowledge of the department and understanding of agriculture and rural communities is needed now more than ever. I know that you will not only bring experience, but also new ideas and creative approaches to help us address the wide range of challenges facing our farm and food sector. Mr. Vilsack, as you know, a lot has changed since you were last at the department. The COVID-19 pandemic changed the world before our very eyes. Many essential food workers were on the front lines without adequate protection. Farmers had no choice but to destroy the crops they could not sell. Millions of families still don't have enough food to eat, and food banks are overwhelmed with unprecedented demand. In the most recent COVID package, Congress provided a new round of investments, including measures to support farmers, protect food workers, and boost food assistance. Today, I look forward to hearing your plans to implement those new provisions and learn about your overall approach to addressing the COVID-19 crisis, especially hunger. The pandemic isn't the only challenge we're facing, though, as we know. The climate crisis poses the greatest threat to the long-term viability of our economy and our food supply. While farmers and foresters are directly affected by climate change, they are also uniquely positioned to be a part of the solution and lead, and to benefit from new streams of income. Exploring these opportunities will be a major focus of this committee, and I look forward to working closely with you and the Biden administration on it. Both of these immediate challenges come against the backdrop of an already struggling farm economy. President Trump's chaotic trade policies destroyed markets that took decades to build. And we've seen staggering levels of farm bankruptcies. Luckily, we are beginning to see a rebound in prices for many crops, which we will monitor closely as we work together and prepare for the next farm bill. Unfortunately, not all farmers had the same opportunity for prosperity in good times or farm support during bad times. It's true that the USDA has a long and sordid history of civil rights abuses and systematic racism that has created economic disparities for farmers of color across the country. It's unacceptable, and it's long past time to address this head on, and I know you agree. I know you've committed to improve fairness and equity for farmers, and I'm anxious to hear more about your plans today as well. On top of all of this, the previous administration mismanaged USDA's ability to address all of these crises, from the destructive relocation of researchers to persistent vacancies. There's a lot of work to do to rebuild the department. Without a strong workforce, USDA can't fulfill its mission to serve our farmers and our families and rural communities. So, Mr. Vilsack, if confirmed, you have a big task ahead, and I know you're up to the job. You have a proven track record and a deep bench of experience to hit the ground running. I'm most impressed by your commitment to embrace new ideas, to usher in a new era for the department. Thank you for being with us today. I look forward to hearing more about your plans and your vision for the USDA. And now I would yield to my friend, my colleague from Iowa, Senator Grassley, to introduce our nominee.
Thank you, Senator Stabenow. Good morning to all my colleagues, and welcome and congratulations to our nominee. It's quite an honor to introduce a fellow Iowan, Thomas J. Vilsack, former two-term governor of Iowa and former Secretary of Agriculture for 8 years in the Obama administration, well known to everybody on this committee. I have a long relationship with Secretary Vilsack. I can't think of a single quarrel that I've had with Governor Vilsack. I know that he knows agriculture very well. He knows the importance of maintaining the institution of the family farm. We have 88,000 of them in Iowa. And he knows that the family farm institution is the foundation of success for American agriculture. And he knows how to faithfully execute the laws at the Department of Agriculture. 8 years of previous actions doing just that. Secretary Vilsack became mayor of Mount Pleasant, Iowa, and at a time that our nation was recovering from maybe the second worst agriculture depression we've had, caused by the farm credit crisis of the 1980s. Much like in those 1980s agriculture depression, the nation is continuing to recover from the impact of the coronavirus and the economic impact that that has. We've seen higher rates of food insecurity, continued food supply chain disruptions, and family farms struggling to balance their books. Should he be confirmed, and I think he will, the experience from the 1980s farm crisis will serve him well at this time of another family farms being under duress. I remember my first discussion with then-to-be Secretary of Agriculture Vilsack in 2009. I brought up with him my work of the involvement in the Pigsford operations. That was to get civil rights and equal rights for black farmers of America. And at the time he was going into office, there was still some carryover that was not being done in the right way by the people who had won their civil rights through the Pigsford cases. And he very definitely worked hard to see that those people got their rights delivered to them. And it was one of my requests of him at that time, because I was involved in the 1990s in those getting justice for those farmers. Secretary Vilsack also has a very strong history of promoting agriculture products both here and abroad. And as a governor, Secretary Vilsack expanded opportunities for green energy, including biofuels, so very, very important for the 43,000 jobs in Iowa. And as secretary, he made investments from the Commodity Credit Corporation to increase the amount of fueling pumps that carry E15 and E85 of ethanol. If confirmed, I'm looking to him to be a voice of reason within the administration on the future of biofuels, as he was in the 8 years that he was a member of the Obama cabinet. Finally, as governor, secretary, and most recently as CEO of the U.S. Dairy Export Council, he knows well U.S. agriculture is dependent upon access to our foreign markets. As former chairman of the Finance Committee, I'm committed to taking down barriers that limit this access and give U.S. agriculture a level playing field. And any U.S. Secretary of Agriculture plays a very important role in that. And Secretary Vilsack, in those 8 years, did that well as too. I'm very encouraged by the success of China Phase One agreement, and I'm glad that the USMCA helped achieve historic gains for agriculture. This work is reflected in the fact that corn and soybeans are highest they've been since 1913. By the way, Secretary Vilsack, in his position as CEO of that U.S. Dairy Export Council, had a news conference with me in Des Moines, Iowa, on the necessity of getting the USMCA passed. So even as a private citizen, he was working very strongly for export of our products. I'm looking forward to working with Secretary Vilsack to increase foreign market access so that our high-quality crops and livestock can be sold across the world. I often say that only 2% of the Americans that farm provide for the other 98% of the Americans, and they do it without a lot of appreciation. If confirmed, I know that Secretary Vilsack will continue to work for the family farmer and spotlight their contributions to agriculture and society. As an Iowan that's part of his nature, just naturally, going way back to his being a lawyer in the small county seat town of Mount Pleasant, Iowa. Please know that you have an open door to my office, Secretary Vilsack, if you or your staff need a helping hand in any of the missions that confront you, and particularly those that confront all Americans because of the coronavirus. I urge all of my colleagues to favorably report your nomination out of committee as soon as possible. It's necessary to get your confirmation through the floor of the Senate very quickly as well. Congratulations, Senator Vilsack, or Secretary Vilsack.
Well, thank you very much, Senator Grassley. Mr. Vilsack, I have two things next to address. First of all, to administer an oath we have to do for all nominees. So please stand and raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So help you God.
I do.
Thank you. And secondly, do you agree that if confirmed, you will appear before any duly constituted committee of Congress if asked to appear?
I will.
Thank you very much. Well, welcome again, and we look forward to hearing from you. And your testimony, as you know, will be made a part of the record in its entirety, so you may proceed as you desire. Welcome.
Thank you, Senator Stabenow, and thanks to you and Senator Bozeman for the opportunity to appear today virtually and for the committee's indulgence. And I want to thank my senator, Senator Grassley, for those kind remarks and certainly for his longtime service to the people of Iowa and the country. He is someone that I have a great deal of admiration for, and I appreciate the fact that he took time to introduce me to the committee today. And it's not lost on me, ironically, that this is Groundhog's Day. And I realize that I'm back again, but I also realize that this is a fundamentally different time, and I am a different person, and it is a different department. And I think we have to recognize that going into this process. When I was getting involved in politics, I followed Robert Kennedy and sort of modeled my views after his, and he often challenged us to think about why not. He used to quote the quote that some people look at things as they are and say why, and others dream of things that never were and say why not. I think we are faced today with a number of why not opportunities and moments in agriculture, in the food industry, and in rural America. Clearly, COVID is on the minds of everyone, as it should be. And the Department of Agriculture has a responsibility to aggressively promote the nutrition assistance that you all have provided. And they have begun to do that in the last week to 10 days. We also, as Senator Bozeman indicated, have to review the additional relief that's been ordered by Congress and try to get that into the hands of farmers, ranchers, producers, and those in rural America as quickly, efficiently, as effectively as possible. We need to make sure that our workers, our essential workers on the line, in the farm fields, in processing facilities and alike are protected and recognized as the essential workers they are. And we certainly need to work collaboratively with the Congress and others to build back the rural economy in better shape than it was before the COVID crisis. But there, I think, are four why not moments that I'd like to briefly address to the committee before taking your questions. I think we are at a why not moment with reference to the climate change. I think there's an opportunity for us to create new markets, incentives for soil health, for carbon sequestration, for methane capture and reuse, by building a rural economy based on biomanufacturing, protecting our forests, turning waste material into new chemicals and materials and fabrics and fibers, creating more jobs in rural America, creating greater farm income stability, and also reducing emissions. I think we've found local leaders, the private sector, the philanthropic sector, and hardworking and the dedicated team at USDA to make a brighter and better future possible in rural America for farmers, ranchers, producers, and those who live, work, and raise their families in rural communities. It is the faith that President Biden and Vice President Harris have placed in me, the confidence they have in us working together that can make a real difference to the country, and especially in rural America. And I look forward to the opportunity to work with all of you and to respond to your questions today.
Thank you so much. And we will begin a round of five-minute questioning, and starting with, I will toss it back to Senator Bozeman.
Thank you very much. Again, thank you for being with us. I'd like to talk a little bit first about trade. Our farmers and ranchers depend on strong relationships around the world. Expanding market access, ensuring that our producers have a level playing field free from non-tariff barriers is certainly critical. In the 2014 Farm Bill, Congress mandated the U.S. Department of Agriculture generate a plan for and implement a new Undersecretary for Trade and Foreign Agricultural Affairs. That role has been useful over the past several years. What is your vision for the mission of this Undersecretary? How can USDA work to strengthen trade policies in the coming year? Lots of discussion already in this meeting about that. And in particular, how will you work with the U.S. Trade Representative, our lead trade negotiator, along with the other trade policymakers throughout the executive branch to make sure that agriculture is a top priority?
Senator, thanks for the question. First of all, as it relates to the Trade Representative's office, I think the USDA has a responsibility of making sure that there's a close communication between the U.S. Trade Representative's office and USDA. I think we need to make sure that we work collaboratively with them to implement existing trade agreements. Specifically, I'm talking about the USMCA. There are issues relating to Canada and Mexico with reference to implementation. I would hope to be able to work closely with USTR on those issues. I think we want to provide advice and counsel and direction and efforts to try to look at additional free trade agreements that could potentially be negotiated during the course of the Biden-Harris administration. I think it's fair to say that we have work to do in terms of making sure that we have a competitive opportunity. Many of our competitors are engaged in free trade agreements that provide a competitive edge in many markets. So we need to reduce that competitive edge. And I think the Undersecretary's office is an incredibly important one to do three things. One, to have a presence in those export markets, to make sure that U.S. agriculture is front and center in the minds of folks who are purchasing and consuming in those markets. Two, I think that office needs to work to create more partnerships in those foreign market opportunities. I know that there are universities, there are other ways in which we can create the kinds of relationships between our agriculture and our food companies and the consumers in these markets. And finally, we need to be part of an effort to continue promotion of U.S. agricultural products. I think if you have more presence, more partnerships, and more promotions, you'll have more trade.
Thank you. President Biden has repeatedly said that climate change will be one of the administration's focuses, and he said that climate change is the number one issue facing humanity. As you know, changes in government can have an impact on the cost of production for producers as well as throughout the food and ag value chain. Last week, the administration unveiled a call to action on climate, calling for input from farmers and ranchers to assess how best to use federal programs to encourage adoption of climate-smart agricultural practices that reduce carbon, create new sources of income and jobs for rural Americans. In addition, the executive order directed the Agriculture Secretary and other agency heads to identify actions that could conserve at least 30% of our lands and waters by 2030, which is a very ambitious goal. In light of this directive, will you pledge to be a voice for farmers, ranchers, producers, and agricultural businesses throughout the food and agricultural value chain? How will you work with them during your time as Secretary with regard to climate policy, rather than let farmers and ranchers be dictated to as we tackle this important issue?
I certainly would make that commitment, Senator. And I share the President's vision of a net zero emission opportunity for U.S. agriculture. I think it would provide us a competitive edge in the world in terms of trade, and would respond to the increasing domestic demand for greater sustainability. I think there are a number of ways in which the department can create efforts to incent and to create new market opportunities that will provide resources and income for farmers and help to create jobs in rural places. I mentioned in my opening statement the bio-based manufacturing opportunity of turning agricultural waste into a variety of products. We know that the success of that with reference to biofuels, that can be expanded dramatically. I think there are ways in which we can invest and create incentives for farmers to continue to expand significantly the work that they are already doing, as you mentioned, with cover crops, no-till, and other soil health efforts. We know more about soil health. We know we need to dedicate ourselves to a more regenerative effort in terms of our soil health. I think there are ways in which we can incent, create market opportunities. I think Senator Braun and Senator Stabenow recognize this. They have suggested that the need for farmer input as we look at carbon capture and sequestration, making sure that the systems that are set up actually can have certified results that make sense, that that will support markets and support the opportunity for these kinds of investments. And I think it's fair to say we will aggressively pursue an effort to get farmer input to make sure that the programs that we design and the programs that we advance are ones that will work out in the field.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And welcome again, Secretary Vilsack. And I want to start first with just the farm economy in general. We've seen such tumultuous years now for our farmers and ranchers. We've seen government payments replace markets as the main driver of farm profitability, and I share with Senator Bozeman's concern about markets and trade and what we need to do to get stability back for our farmers and our ranchers. We're gonna continue to have challenges, we know, because of the pandemic and it moving forward. It is good to see bright spots like corn and soybean wheat prices recently hitting their highest in the last 6 years. That's good news. But taking a step back, how can we return to a sense of normalcy in the farm economy with a focus on responsible risk management and building markets for producers, which really has been the foundation of our farm bills in recent years?
Senator, that's an incredibly complicated question, and I'll do my best to try to respond in a short period of time. It indeed starts with markets. Historically, we've obviously looked at export market opportunities. Anywhere from 20 to 30% of what's produced in this country gets exported. So clearly a stable, secure trade policy that doesn't create havoc in the market, that doesn't put us at a competitive disadvantage would be helpful in terms of our ability to sell product overseas. Expanding market opportunities in new market, I think Southeast Asia is an opportunity. I think eventually over time, we're going to see potential opportunities in Africa. One half of the world's increased population is liable to come in the next 15 years in that single continent. So we want to obviously be engaged in trade opportunities there as they evolve. Certainly our competitors are doing that. But it's more than just export markets. It's growing markets here domestically. By investing in a robust local and regional food system that creates market opportunities for small and mid-sized producers so they can negotiate their own price. We began that process in the Obama administration, but I think there's much, much more work that could be done in that space. It's about creating new markets, markets that have never been developed before. Carbon sequestration and storage, if done the right way. The opportunity for methane capture and reuse, if done the right way. The development of bio-based manufacturing that creates new market opportunities for agricultural waste, if done in the right way, can all create a more stable farm income and economy, and can also help to create and support the jobs that many farm families need as well in rural places. It's also about making sure that we have a safety net that operates. I mean, our farmers are definitely more interested in markets than they are aid, but there are times and circumstances that it requires significant investment by the government. We need to be prepared to do that. We need policies and programs that allow and enable that. And we need obviously a strong crop insurance program that provides protection in the event that Mother Nature simply won't cooperate. So it's all of that and probably much, much more, but
Thank you. Yes, that's a very comprehensive answer in a few moments. And you know, I couldn't agree with you more on all of those points. And I wondered if you could just take a moment to go a little bit more specific in the climate arena. As you mentioned, Senator Braun and I have bipartisan legislation, members of our committee, others am very interested in this. And our drumbeat is that whatever is done, it needs to be voluntary, producer-led, bipartisan, and that it really starts with what producers have told us about the lack of qualified technical assistance. So we know farmers are, from the hearings we did last year in this committee, already doing things that are making a difference, that are capturing carbon and lessening the carbon pollution. But there's so much more that could be done, and the Growing Climate Solutions Act is really about setting up that structure and the need to have that support for farmers. Could you speak a little bit more to that?
With your permission, I think there are many proposals contained in what you and Senator Braun and others have proposed that could be essentially implemented administratively. For example, putting together an advisory group of farmers that would give us a better understanding and appreciation of how to structure a carbon sequestration, a carbon bank effort, making sure that we can, in fact, adequately measure and quantify the results that can be obtained by farmers, making sure that the benefits of whatever program we devise and develop accrue to the benefit of farmers and not necessarily to third parties, making sure that we promote the development of ecosystem markets that create those revenue sources for farmers, making sure that our conservation programs are structured and designed in a way that encourage and incent the kind of activities we know make a difference. Our soil is precious. We need to make sure we're investing in soil health. And we also, frankly, need to up our game on research. There are ways in which root systems of crops can potentially be designed in a way that will sequester more carbon. We ought to be exploring that. We ought to be looking at ways in which we can increase market opportunities for greater storage. I think agriculture has as its is probably the first and best way to begin getting some wins in this climate area. I think farmers are prepared for it. Farmers are anxious to do it. If it's voluntary, if it's market-based, if it's incentive-based, I think you will see farmers, ranchers, and producers cooperate extensively.
Thank you. I couldn't agree more, and I know there's a number of different bills that we will want to be looking at as well, Senator Thune and I, and looking at the expanding the soil health demonstration project and cover crops and whole range of things. So I think that's a real an opportunity for agriculture, forestry, and others to really lead, show folks how to be able to do this right. So thank you very much. All right. We have, I'm just looking here, Senator Ernst was next on the list. I believe she is not here. She's not virtual, correct, at the moment? So, so Senator Hyde-Smith.
I can't hear the senator, so.
I think we need to have a button pushed. Yes.
Yep. Sorry, I hit it. Again, congratulations on the nomination. I apologize I did not hit the microphone correctly, but have enjoyed working with you in the past as former Commissioner of Agriculture in Mississippi, and agriculture is the number one industry in Mississippi. One out of every four jobs there in my home state is related to agriculture, so obviously very important position that you're embarking upon. Mr. Secretary, farmers have had several difficult years, as you're very aware of, the bad weather, low prices, and export market losses, and now coronavirus. Unfortunately, there's another growing concern that I'm hearing about from my farmers and ranchers. Last June, a petition was filed in the Department of Commerce and the International Trade Commission seeking countervailing duties on phosphate fertilizer imports. Since that petition, fertilizer supplies have tightened across the country and phosphate fertilizer prices are substantially up 25% or more. How concerned are you about maintaining adequate supply of these fertilizers, and what are your plans for ensuring reliable markets for this critical ag import for farmers?
Senator, I had an opportunity recently to visit with Senator Moran about this issue, and so I'm certainly aware of the importance of it. And one of the responsibilities, I think, as the Secretary of Agriculture is to communicate to sister agencies the impact and effect of decisions that they are making, making sure that they fully understand and appreciate the effect of whatever decision they are considering as it relates to farmers, ranchers, and producers, making sure that we have conversation and communication. So one thing I would expect to do is to reach out to the Commerce Department to determine whether or not there is anything that can be done that would put us in a more competitive circumstance and ensure the supply of fertilizer throughout the U.S. I also think it's important for the Department of Agriculture, when faced with circumstances where, for whatever reason, a rule or regulation is impacting and affecting folks out on the farm, looking for ways in which we can utilize the tools of the USDA to provide some kind of transition assistance or provide some kind of way of mitigating the impact and effect. And certainly, I would task our team to take a look at whether or not there's anything we could do at USDA specifically and directly to address this issue. And finally, I would say that I think it's important and necessary to point out that there are ways in which we can help producers utilize fertilizer in the most effective way, using it at the right time, the right place, the right amounts, that we don't over-fertilize. Sometimes is unfortunately is happening in many parts of the country. And I think there are also opportunities, as I said earlier, to convert agricultural waste into a variety of products, including a pelletized fertilizer that would be transportable, storable, and create a new market opportunity for farmers. So I think there are a multitude of ways to address this issue.
Thank you very much for that answer, because it is quite a concern. And another thing I want to mention while I have a few moments left is the forest and wood products industry provides great jobs in rural areas throughout the country, including Mississippi. In addition to providing important economic support to rural economies, working forests, obviously, they also provide for clean air, clean water, and wildlife habitat. Ensuring growing markets for wood products is critical for these rural economies and environmental benefits. One of the other things that concerns me is their eligibility for programs when they lose timber. We're a hurricane state, we're a tornado state. Last Easter, we experienced tornadoes, and there were no programs for the loss of that timber for the individuals. But what are your views on how USDA can strengthen and grow markets for wood products, including leading on new and innovative wood products like mass timber?
Well, first of all, I think it's to take a look at the procurement position and opportunities that USDA itself has and that other departments of the government have in terms of how they might be able to use wood in construction opportunities, projects that we have with the Forest Service, projects that the Defense Department has, just to name two. There are ways, I think, where we can encourage where it's appropriate for the use of wood. When I was secretary before, we focused and began the process of trying to encourage the construction of tall buildings with cross-laminated timber. I think there's still an opportunity there as well to help spur that new market, look for ways in which we can incent and encourage and educate people about the capacity of using cross-laminated timber as structural members, not necessarily decorative, but structural members in tall buildings. There are a number of projects that are taking place in the U.S. and certainly quite a few projects taking place in other parts of the world that I think showcase that opportunity. There are also potentially biomass opportunities in terms of energy production as we look at renewable fuels. The challenge here, Senator, and I think it's important, is that we want to be able to figure out how to use this wood. We want to be able to preserve the carbon that's in the wood. As we know, we've had horrific forest fires, which is not necessarily the issue in Mississippi, but it is in other parts of the country. And to the extent that we can better manage our forests, better provide opportunities for markets, we can reduce that risk of forest fires and we can keep that carbon stored for a lot longer.
Again, congratulations and thank you for answering my questions.
Thank you very much. And if I might just as an aside, Senator Highsmith, I'm looking forward to working with you on the issue of timber. Michigan State University just built its tallest multi-floor building and is really doing a lot of research around this as well. So look forward to working with you on that. Senator Brown, I believe, is joining us virtually. Senator Brown. Excuse me. I'm sorry. No. We are Senator Klobuchar.
Thank you very much, Senator Stabenow. And thank you for your service, Secretary Vilsack, and thank you for returning to service as well. And I wanted to start by asking about our renewable fuels, something near and dear to the hearts of the people in your home state of Iowa, as well as in Minnesota. Just what's happening, as you know, at the end of last year, there were some very, in last administration, some very bad decisions made from my perspective by the administration about waivers to oil companies. And we've had 150 ethanol plants that have shut down in our country or operated lesser capacity. And could you talk about what your plans are in a little more detail when it comes to biofuels? And also, I introduced the Renewable Fuel Infrastructure Act in December with Senator Ernst to build upon the infrastructure program. We're going to reintroduce the bill next week, and I think that could be helpful as well. So your comments on biofuels and what you'll do as secretaries, including about the refinery exemptions and how the past administration interpreted them.
There are a number of things that the Department of Agriculture relating to biofuels. First and foremost, our own vehicles and the utilization of biofuels in the various the vehicle fleet that USDA has. Certainly want to make sure that that's occurring and encouraging our sister agencies as they look at vehicles, as they look at marine fuels, and look at jet fuel, to look at ways in which they can utilize biofuels appropriately and effectively and to spur the industry. Secondly, working with
Secretary, that above you are, or Secretary to be, your four naval hats. You want to describe that to people, what those hats are?
Well, three of the hats are from ships that I was on that were being refueled with biofuel. It was an amazing experience being in the middle of the Pacific Ocean and watch the refueling process. And the Navy was basically, with their new green fleet, making a commitment to biofuels. I think marine and aviation fuel are the future for biofuels, and I think we need to figure out ways in which we can encourage that. We obviously, the USDA secretary is closely with his or her partner at EPA to make sure that folks at EPA fully understand and appreciate the benefits of this industry in terms of jobs, in terms of the environment, in terms of life cycle analysis. This industry has made great strides in becoming much more environmentally friendly than it was at the beginning. And sometimes I fear that we're still working off of old research. New research would suggest and indicate that this is an industry that is providing environmental benefits, cleaner air, for example. And making sure that as they make decisions relative to the renewable fuel standard, that they are consistent, that they are consistent with the rule, they're consistent with the law. The waiver system was designed for small refineries that were having trouble and difficulty. It was not a design for large scale refineries that are owned by Exxon and Chevron to receive a waiver. So I would hope and will certainly strongly urge EPA to go back to a day when those waivers are very, very, very infrequently granted. And then finally, I think there's a way in which we can utilize USDA resources and work with Congress to increase those resources to build out the infrastructure to make it easier for higher blends to be available to consumers. Why? Because at the end of the day, consumers benefit. They have less expensive fuel. They have a cleaner burning fuel. They have a fuel that's better for the environment. And as we look at the future, I think biofuels continue to play a role in reducing emissions and providing job opportunities in all parts of the country.
Thank you. I know I just have two last questions here. You earlier discussed some issues with Senator Stabenow about climate and environmental issues. I know it's going to be one of your focuses, and I believe, like so many on the committee do, that farmers should be a major part of this. And one of the ways you do that, in addition to the sequestration that I heard you talk about, is getting the data and making sure we know how best practices work, things like cover crops. I happen to know, having spent some time in Iowa, that there was a pilot program in your state about that. Senator Thune and I had this bill called the Agriculture Data Act, to better get more information and data for our farmers? And you agree that research and data are important tools, and can you commit to finish the pilot program and examining the additional research opportunities that we could use data with? And the USDA is so important on that front.
Certainly agree that data and research is important. And we, as I said earlier, I think we need to up our game as it relates to the data and research in this area. Happy to take a look at the pilot, figure out ways in which that can be assisted and ways in which potentially the benefits or the information from that pilot can be distributed throughout the countryside and to the extent replicated. One of the keys with cover crops is creating market opportunities for those cover crops. It's one thing to ask farmers to essentially put the cover crop on there for soil health. It's another thing when we're asking them to incur an additional expense. So I would hope that we'd be able to figure out a ways in which we could mitigate the impact financially at the same by creating new markets or creating ways in which they can be incented or encouraged to do more cover cropping.
Thank you. And last, Senator Cornyn and I included a provision in the 2018 Farm Bill creating a national animal vaccine and veterinary countermeasures vaccine bank and a program involving preparedness, as we've seen from this pandemic, which hasn't hit our animals in any big way, but it sure hit a lot of people. What are your plans for implementing and improving animal disease preparedness and response policies at USDA?
I think it's fair to say there's a recognition that animal health and human health are connected. And we have to understand this is a one health system, and we need to make sure that we are in a position to first and foremost be able to detect more quickly at the farm gate when there's a problem so we can respond more quickly. We need to make sure that we have in place appropriate quarantine efforts. We have to make sure that we have in place the ability to identify the problem as quickly as possible. And to your point, there needs to be the capacity to produce the vaccine and or store the vaccine to be able to respond quickly. Because the reality is if we don't respond quickly, there is not just the risk to animals and to the markets, but there's also risk to people. And I think we have to understand the interconnection between the two.
Thank you very much. And I'll ask my questions on the record on Cuba. You and I share an interest in continuing to work on production issues and trade with Cuba, as well as broadband and the CRP program. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And we will now go to Senator Hovind. And I do want to indicate, because we have members that are joining us virtually as well as in person, if you step away virtually, make sure that we know you're back. We don't want to have you lose the ability to be able to ask your questions and so on. So we want to make sure we know who's with us. So Senator Hovind.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and greetings, Secretary Vilsack. Appreciate the opportunity we've had to work together as governors and during your first stint as Secretary of Agriculture, and I look forward to working with you in the future as Secretary of Agriculture on behalf of our great farmers and ranchers, the best in the world. Recently, USDA froze more than $2 billion of the CFAP funding. Are you committed to continuing to get that funding out and then following the directives in the legislation that Congress included?
I am, Senator. I hope that you understand and appreciate the fact that any new administration needs to have an opportunity to fully understand and appreciate exactly what has taken place with reference to that fund, what commitments have been made, what commitments have already been embraced. We just simply need time to have a better understanding of where that is. It is not designed for anything other than to give me, if I'm confirmed, a better sense of that program. Obviously, we're going to follow the directives of Congress. I mean, that's reasonable and appropriate, and that's the way it should operate. I would say that we are going to continue to look for ways in which the tools that USDA has can be utilized in the best possible way to provide the assistance that people need to help build the economy back better, to expand opportunities when and if that presents itself. But if there's directive from Congress, we'll obviously follow it.
Two I particularly worked on are both the WIP Plus and making sure that we had follow-on funding to finish out the full intent of the WIP Plus funding, and then also QLA, Quality Loss Adjustment, something that I included both language and funding for, and would ask that in particular, as you work on those, that you would coordinate with our office.
Happy to work with your office, and also would encourage us to provide input that we can make sure that the folks at the local level fully understand and appreciate exactly how this program is supposed, these programs are supposed to work. I've received some indication from folks that maybe there's a disconnect between what's happening on the ground and what the intent was. We want to make sure there is consistency there. And to the extent that you can provide help and assistance to give us direction and instruction so our local folks know exactly what they need to do, that would be helpful, Senator.
Thank you. I appreciate that. We will do that. And also on Precision Ag, the RISE program, something I mentioned when you and I talked earlier, we've actually secured two rounds of funding for that. I think there's about $10 million. That's a new program. It's going to be great for Precision Ag. Same thing. And if we could have that same approach on RISE, I would greatly appreciate it.
Well, absolutely. And I'm glad to see that you all have made the decision to focus and invest in this area. Because as we deal with climate, as we deal with increased productivity, as we deal with farm income, and as we encourage soil health, precision agriculture becomes an important consideration. But to the extent that we can invest in it, learn from it, absolutely appreciate it.
Yeah, and it rises rural innovation, stronger economy. I use the acronym, but I think this is exactly the kind of thing that can have a very big impact. And I know you share that enthusiasm, and I appreciate that very much. On the carbon capture, we've talked about it a lot. I'd just like to emphasize, and of course, I'm certainly willing to work with our chairman. She's, I know, a strong leader in that area, and our ranking member. He and I work close on everything. But it has to be farmer-friendly. Has to be farmer-friendly. Could you respond to that?
Well, I think there is a concern that a carbon sequestration bank would potentially benefit investors or benefit third parties. It has to be structured and devised and designed in a way that the principal beneficiaries are farmers. Why? Because we want them to do this. We want to encourage it. We want to incent it. Why do we want that? Because it's a quick win in terms of climate change. And I think the farm community is really ready for this. There have been conversations in every major commodity group about this. There is a commitment to proceed forward. Farmers know how to do this. We need to embrace them and encourage them and incent them. And so whatever system we devise, whatever incentive program, whatever program we put together, it's got to be, there has to be farmer input, and it has to, at the end of the day, benefit farmers. And if it does, I think there'll be wide adoption of it.
As formerly chair on Ag Approach, now ranking member, we work with the CCC, and the first priority of the CCC has always been funding the farm programs. I guess my question would be, do you feel that that the CCC is something that you would want to use for some type of carbon program, and are you willing to commit that the CCC has to be there to fund the priorities in the farm program first and foremost?
The first responsibility of the Commodity Credit Corporation is to make sure that the Farm Bill programs are adequately, fully, and timely funded.
Good.
Having said that, Senator, to the extent that that vehicle is available without compromising the ability to fund the Farm Bill programs, it is a great tool for us to create the kind of structure that will inform future Farm Bills about what will encourage carbon sequestration, what will encourage precision agriculture, what will encourage soil health and regenerative agricultural practices. And to that extent, to the extent that there are resources available, I would hope that you all would provide me the opportunity to utilize that in a way, again, that doesn't compromise the Farm Bill programs, but advances and creates additional markets. Secretary Perdue had great flexibility, appropriately so, under the current COVID situation. I would ask for the opportunity to use that flexibility appropriately, effectively, and smartly to create the opportunity for you as you put together the next Farm Bill to understand what works and what would be helpful in terms of programs.
We did use it to help with the trade, and I am encouraged. We are seeing more trade now, and we've seen some help there in terms of prices. I hope that continues. We know our producers want markets, and that's what we're all after. Two kind of final questions I'll be quick. One is, we've got to do more for our livestock producers. We've got to get them more transparency and pricing in the market. We've got incredible concentration on the processor side. We've got to find ways to address that. That's a huge priority. If you could respond to that. And then one other point, Forest Service, we do need your help with the Forest Service. And it is part of the, as you know very well, part of the Department of Ag. We have ranchers out there in the grasslands. We need your commitment to help with those ranchers out in the grasslands. So if you could just finish with responding to those two issues.
In 30 seconds.
Yeah. And I apologize, Madam Chairman, for going over.
Yeah.
We'll work collaboratively with farmers and ranchers in terms of access to forest land. I've now forgotten your question, Senator. Sorry.
Well, first, help for livestock producers and then enforcers.
Look, there's no question. We need to strengthen the laws that are designed to create more openness and more transparency and more price discovery. No question about that. But that's not enough. I think we need alternative processing opportunities. Why? Not just from the competitive standpoint, but also from a resilience standpoint. We found that when one or two processing facilities shut down during COVID, that it created havoc in the market. We can't have that. We have to have a more resilient food system, and that, in my view, requires us to look at ways in which we can incent and encourage more processing facilities.
Thank you, and then help with the Forest Service for our ranchers.
I thought I responded to that.
Okay, Okay, thank you very much. And again, Madam Chairman, thank you. I apologize for going over my time. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Senator Bennett.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Senator Hoeven, for that question about processing. It's an important issue that we've got to address. Mr. Secretary, thank you for your willingness to serve and for your family's willingness to sacrifice. We deeply appreciate it, and I'm very grateful that you're back. As I think you know, our national forests are an essential part of our infrastructure throughout the West, providing water for our cities, sustaining agriculture, and driving our outdoor recreation economy. I want to say to the members of this committee, in case you know them, this infrastructure is as important to our country as the Lincoln Tunnel is to Chuck Schumer and to New York. And as you noted in your testimony, they also provide some of the best carbon capture systems that exist. You know, we're still not managing our forests like the critical infrastructure they are. And with climate change driving hotter and drier conditions, we're experiencing more catastrophic wildfires across the West, including the three largest in Colorado's history last year. Just in the last 3 years alone, NOAA tells us that this country spent these fires cost our country $46 billion, and that doesn't even include the economy, that doesn't even include health. $43 billion up in smoke in 3 years. And Mr. Secretary, that's why I recently introduced a bill that would set aside $60 billion and partner with our state and local governments to get this critical forest restoration work done across the West. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about what your priorities are going to be for the national forests ahead. What it would mean to the Forest Service, what they could achieve if, in terms of wildfire risk, jobs, and avoiding costs if we actually did what's required, and what we should honor. These are national forests in our states.
Senator, when I hear folks talk about infrastructure, invariably there is a discussion about roads and bridges and locks and dams and ports and airports, all of which are incredibly important, and we absolutely require significant investment in improving the infrastructure of this country so we remain competitive in a global market and that we can provide safe and secure access for the people of this country. But I wonder why we don't also include the force in that conversation, because to me, they represent a major infrastructure for the country. You mentioned carbon sequestration. The reality is a clean air directly connected to forests. Obviously, as we deal with trying to make our kids as healthy as they can, the outdoor recreational opportunities, the economy, the impact of forest in terms of outdoor recreation, hunting, fishing, biking, hiking, et cetera, all very, very significant, job growth connected to it. So I would hope that as the Congress deals with infrastructure issues and decides to commit significant resources to rebuilding the infrastructure of this country, that they would include forests in that conversation. Because if they do, we can do a better job of maintaining the forests. In the meantime, I think it's up to the United States Department of Agriculture to use the fire budget fix that you all did enact more effectively and more efficiently, and utilizing that resource to do a better job to make sure that we're not diverting money away from the important job of maintaining and managing our forests. And I'm encouraged by the president's call for a conservation corps. We can put people to work. We can create new opportunities for folks as we do a better job of maintaining and repairing our forests. So I think the Forest Service has tremendous opportunities here. And I look forward to working with you on your bill and any other way in which we can provide the resources to do a better job of forest management.
And I appreciate that, Mr. Secretary. And I think the Conservation Corps is a really good idea, but we could create 2 million jobs in rural America, in the West, and probably in other places too, and in many communities that are facing a transition away from fossil fuels. This would create a real opportunity to drive incomes and drive jobs. In the limited time I have left, Mr. Secretary, it's my fault. I know, as you know, rural communities throughout our country and in Colorado face many of the same infrastructure challenges as larger communities, but they often face it with fewer resources and fewer staff. Too often, local staff are left to navigate the federal bureaucracy with little help. The pandemic has only made this problem worse, and I'm worried that it will set rural areas even further behind on broadband and infrastructure projects. There are steps that agencies can take to help, for example, simplifying application requirements, increasing field staff, improving coordination would help those rural communities compete for funding. You're now going to be in this job a second time, have the benefit of having been there before. So under your leadership, how will you make it easier for small and rural communities to access USDA's rural infrastructure funding?
It begins by providing the technical assistance so people actually know what they need to do. We put together in the previous administration a thing called Strike Force, which was designed to provide a partnership between community building organizations and the USDA to create area opportunities in persistently poor areas of the country for investment of all of our programs, not just our rural utility service programs, rural business development programs, all of our programs. And the reality is we first have to teach folks how to play the game. And that provides technical assistance. And we have to basically guarantee success. We have to work with them long enough and hard enough to basically get to yes. And I think I'm committed to doing that in persistently poor areas in particular, but across the country. We need to improve the technical assistance that we provide. And I think if we did that, we would see better utilization of the resources and get more help to more people.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I'm over time, but I would say Senator Bozeman mentioned that the president's executive order directs the Secretary of Agriculture to collect input from farmers and ranchers to use federal programs to encourage adoption and climate-smart agricultural practices. We've been having a series of meetings in Colorado with farmers and ranchers for the last several years who are adapting to drought, communities dealing with reduced snowpack, and local elected leaders who are facing these rising costs of wildfire that you and I were just talking about. And so, Mr. Secretary, I would like to invite you to come to Colorado at your soonest opportunity to begin to have those listening sessions on climate. We'd roll a red carpet out for you.
Senator, to that opportunity.
Okay, the red carpet, Senator Bennett. Okay, we're not sure exactly what that means in Colorado. I would come. Yes, all right, Senator Bozeman. We're going to go to Colorado for the. They're going to roll out the red carpet. This is good. This is good. So,
Senator,
all right. Thank you,
Senator. I think it means an opportunity for me to see my grandson, granddaughter, son, and daughter-in-law. I think that's
that would definitely be the red carpet. That would definitely be. So, thank you. Well, at this moment, I don't believe we have present a Republican colleagues at least at this moment. And so Senator Brown was next on the list, so I'm not sure we have him with us either.
You do.
Oh, we thank do. You. Senator Brown. Yes.
Thank you, Senator Stabenow. Yes. If I call you Madam Chair, and I appreciate the generosity of Senator Bozeman in doing this flip that is inevitable and I believe will happen tomorrow, but thank you for doing that. Secretary Vilsack, good to see you again remotely before the committee. I appreciate our meeting of a few days ago. Thank you for that. We know this, we've seen this pandemic as the great revealer in so many ways, how vulnerable people are and how much suffering there is out there and why we need another package to help the American public. It's not just to fix the economy, it's to relieve suffering for so many people. The Dayton mother who needs SNAP benefits to put food on the table, the worker not too far from your home state, the workers in Sioux Falls at the meatpacking plant who have to choose between a paycheck and safety at the workplace. Always, always important to understand these essential workers are people who, as one essential worker said to me, and I don't feel that essentially, I feel expendable, they don't pay me much and they don't protect me in the job. And that's up to you and up to the DOL and up to this government, something we haven't seen happen in a while. So my question is this: how do we improve coordination between means-tested programs so that women and children already WIC eligible are actually receiving the benefit? We know the take-up's not as high as it should be. I know you struggled with that before. What do we do to make that work?
Well, two things. I think that USDA needs to do a better job of educating people about the existence of the program, and I think we need to figure out creative ways to get folks interested in WIC. In addition to the nutrition opportunities, let me give you an example. There's a program that is operating in 12 states called Count the Kicks. It's a way of basically preventing stillbirths by counting the kicks. If we have things like this that are also tied, educational opportunities that are also tied to WIC participation, maybe we get a broader awareness. This would be particularly true in communities of color to basically get that, because they have much higher stillborn rates than among white moms. So the opportunity here, I think, is to create ways in which people see multiple benefits from programs. Secondly, I think it's important to get state and local leaders engaged in this as well. I think governors, I think mayors, I think state representatives, state senators have a responsibility to make sure that people are aware of programs, aware how to get involved in programs. We need to look at ways in which we can create a much easier way of getting into these programs. I mean, if you're qualified for one program, is it not a way in which we could create a way to have eligibility to a multitude of programs without necessarily requiring people to apply three or four or five different times, answering the same questions three or four different times, and doing it in three or four different offices. Making the access to these programs more convenient, I think, educating people about the benefits and expanding the benefits would be three ways, I think, where you could encourage increased participation.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. You came out and during your time with the Obama administration were very helpful in helping us with algae bloom, helping us combat algae blooms in the Western Basin of Lake Erie, the shallowest of the Great Lakes, as you know. The states, the Congress allows states to pay up to 90% of the cost of 10 high priority equipped programs. Many states and club have declined to do so. How do we encourage all states to take advantage of that?
Well, I think as we begin to have conversations about issues involving soil health, regenerative agriculture, new opportunities for farmers and ranchers, it's going to drive people to the practices that will reduce the risk of algae blooms, that will reduce the capacity of over-fertilization that leads to these kinds of situations. So it becomes in the best interest of a governor, in the best interest of a secretary or commissioner of agriculture, to advocate for this and to utilize those opportunities. Because at the end of the day, more productive soil means more profit for farmers. New market opportunities means more jobs and more income for farmers. So I think you make the economic case. And by doing so, you encourage folks to amplify the message. And I think with this climate discussion, Senator, we're going to have a lot of opportunity to visit with and to work with collectively and collaboratively with state and local governments. Because they're going to see the economic benefit in addition to the environmental benefit. The joining of those two ideas, I think, is very powerful.
Well, from my observation, I don't really know, but people tell me the President of the United States chose you to be USDA Secretary, and your experience, but in large part your vision and your clear-sightedness and ability to look into the future on climate issues. And so we really, Lake Erie is one component of that. So is John Tester's farm in Montana. So the lowlands in Bangladesh, we know all that. One last question. We talked about the pandemic being the great revealer. We saw pictures last year of farmers plowing under crops and dairies dumping milk because of the huge decline in demand. this past year served as a wake-up call for many of us that while we may have the most efficient food supply in the world, it's not as resilient as we thought. Improving local and regional farm systems a way not only to invest in rural communities, but make our farms, our food system more equitable and more sustainable. How do you build on previous work that you've done and others have done to diversify our food supply chain, including local agriculture, while helping small and medium-sized farms?
Well, you continue to look for ways in which you can create market opportunities for those small and mid-sized operations. You basically expand significantly the farm to school, farm to university, farm to college, farm to prison, farm to whatever institutional purchaser may be buying food in the locality, creating ways in which that institutional purchaser of food understands what's being grown and raised. You finance food hubs so that small producers can aggregate the amount of food that they're producing with other similar sized farm operations so that you have uniformity in processing and packaging and marketing. You obviously continue to expand commitment to farmers markets. You look for ways in which you create risk management tools for those small and mid-sized producers so there's more profit opportunity. You create a transition assistance so people who are interested in going into organic can do it more easily. I mean, Senator, there are a multitude of ways to promote local and regional food systems that the Department of Agriculture can utilize existing resources to promote and to provide expansion for. And frankly, it's in everyone's best interest to have this. You also have to expand processing facilities. You have to give people the opportunity to not necessarily to rely on a handful of large processing facilities. You need to create more of that. You started that process with the most recent COVID bill with a small program for processing. It's got to be much, much bigger than that, in my view. You also have a dairy donation program, which I think is an incredibly good idea because there's a disincentive now. You have to spend money to process in order to be able to get it to food banks. You have to make sure that food banks have the infrastructure to collect, store, and refrigerate perishable items if you want more of that to go into the food assistance network if we have a disruption in food service. So there's an entire supply chain program here that needs to be put in place, and USDA can impact and affect every single aspect of that supply chain.
Madam Chair, thank you. Mr. Secretary, thank you very much for serving.
Thank you very much. We'll go now to Senator Ernst, and I will remind members, I believe we have a vote that will start at noon. And so, but we will continue on through as many members as we can. So, Senator Ernst.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Secretary Vilsack, for joining us here today. It's great to have you with us again, and you do bring a unique perspective to this position. Not only have you had the opportunity to serve as our Agriculture Secretary before, but of course, more importantly, for Senator Grassley and I, you bring a unique perspective being from Iowa. And it is my hope that if you are confirmed to the position again, that you will stand firm for our farmers and ranchers in Iowa as you work to implement the new policies of this new administration. So as you know, Iowa, and you know this intimately, but Iowa is a top producer of our biofuels, both ethanol and biodiesel. A new report released just last week found that greenhouse gas emissions from corn ethanol are 46% lower than gasoline. The executive order, however, last week establishes a policy to change the federal vehicle fleet over to electric vehicles. And in light of this announcement, will you be directing the USDA to purchase Tesla trucks or that run on electricity, or will you be supporting our farmers and purchasing Ford F-150s that run on E85?
Senator, I think I don't think it's an either-or circumstance. I think there's an opportunity to advance both. I mean, the reality is we're going to need biofuels in the biofuel industry for the foreseeable future. And you mentioned the study that came out. I think it's a Harvard-based study that I think underscores the fact that as we educate people about the environmental benefits of biofuels, we will see, I think, the opportunity to expand the utilization of biofuels. I mentioned earlier the importance of marine and aviation fuel. It's not just transportation, truck cars and trucks. It's also jets and ships that will use this fuel. So I think we look for expanded opportunities in a variety of different ways. At the same time, I think we recognize that there will be more and more electric vehicles that will be utilized in the country. And we also recognize that that's going to require energy. Where does that energy come from? Well, I think there's opportunities within rural America to promote rural renewable energy, which can also be beneficial to the farmers and ranchers and producers that we care about.
And I certainly hope that you continue to echo that sentiment very loudly and clearly with the administration, because my concern is this, that, you know, as much as my Democratic colleagues would like to talk about Donald Trump and biofuels, you know, all day long, but when President Obama, your old boss, came to Iowa, he made a lot of really significant promises to these farmers and those in the biofuel industry. And I would argue that the reality is he simply wasn't a champion. We didn't see E15 year-round under his administration. He wasn't that champion. He put out the WOTUS rule, too, which was an attack on agriculture. So let's think ahead. 2022 is coming up. It is a significant milestone for the RFS. The renewable fuel standard will need to be reauthorized. And if confirmed, which I anticipate you will be confirmed, you will be sitting in the Oval Office with President Biden in 2022. Just imagine yourself there, and you are there discussing the opportunity for the RFS, but you also have an electric vehicle advocate sitting across the table. What will you do in your capacity to make sure we get this done, get the renewal of the RFS done, when we are facing near unanimous support of Democrats when it comes to electric vehicles? What is the way you would handle this as Secretary of Agriculture?
Well, I'd probably say to President Biden, I'd probably remind him that I have a 2006 Ford Focus that I still own. So I've owned it for, 14, 15 years, 17 years? No, 15 years. I would remind him that there are so many, many Americans like me and my wife who have cars that are 6, 7, 8, 10, 12 years old. And the reality is that we're going to need both. We're going to need a biofuel industry that promotes, as you pointed out, the greenhouse gas emission savings over gasoline. We're going to promote biofuels because of the octane capacity. So if we're really interested in expanding mileage over time, one way to do that is by having biofuels, higher blend biofuels that will expand mileage with new engines. And the reality is that General Motors and Ford and all of those other car companies, they're not going to stop producing combustion engines, cars with combustion engines. They're not going to stop that process. So we need an alternative fuel source in addition to add to complement our efforts on the electric. I don't see why we can't have both. And over a long period of time, we're going to need both. And while we're developing and ensuring that the infrastructure is in place, something the Obama administration did invest in, additional infrastructure to increase the opportunities for E15 to be utilized in several thousand gas stations around the country. While we're doing that, we also need to look for ways in which we can incorporate biofuels, as I said before, in other forms of transportation. And I think there are tremendous opportunities in aviation and marine fuel as well. So I think there's a future for this industry. I think that there are jobs connected to this industry. There's stability of farm income connected to this industry. I don't think I'm going to have to be too persuasive in that Oval Office to have the president who committed to the RFS during the course of the campaign to follow through on that commitment.
And thank you, Secretary. I do hope you stand strong. I have a question that I will submit for the record, but it is about the 30 by 30 climate proposal. It was a climate executive order. It was a proposal to conserve 30% of U.S. land by 2030. And I know that that is also very concerning to our farmers to have a proposal that would limit the opportunity to them to farm with widespread retirement of farmland. So I will submit that for the record and look forward to your response. Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you. And in the interest of time here as we move forward, so members know, Senator Leahy is next, then assuming we have time here, Senator Grassley, Casey, Fisher, Smith, Braun, Gillibrand. Those are the names that I have here, and I believe I just saw Senator Thune enter the room, so welcome. Senator Leahy, I believe you're with us.
Thank you.
Yes.
Is it coming through okay?
It is. Thank you.
Good. Well, thank you very much. And Mr. Secretary, it's good to see you, even though it's like this. And we had a good chat the other day. I know we welcomed you in Vermont. We can't provide a grandchildren for you the way my colleague can in Colorado. But, you know, every time you've been in Vermont, everybody's been happy to see you, Republicans and Democrats alike. And so we will see you there again, I hope. And it is so important what you do. Incidentally, I'm glad to see that somebody has cars as old as the cars my wife and I have. But your department helps our nation's farmers, our rural communities, underserved families. And look at the coronavirus pandemic, what that's done to us, hunger, climate change, economic disruption. That's communities all over the country, certainly in my own state of Vermont, but everywhere else. And it's also shown us that race and gender, geography affect how Americans experience crises. I think we have to make sure that President Biden and you can work to make sure that not only in Vermont, but all over the country, we have access to resources we need. I'll put, Madam Chair, my full statement in the record. And I assume that's without objection.
And, without objection, yes.
And last year marked the 30th anniversary of the, certainly one of my proudest achievements in passing the Organic Food Production Act. It's now a $55 billion per year industry. It's certainly been an economic factor in all parts of our country. But there are several long overdue rulemakings, which you initiated when you were secretary before. They're critical to maintain this. The origin of livestock rules, closing loopholes, and so on. That's, we had mandated in the fiscal year 2020 appropriations bill, the USDA complete the rule by June 17th of last year. Your predecessor did not. Can I ask that you look at that and see if the congressional mandate can be met and have those rules completed?
Senator, it's my intention to be supportive of the organic industry, and I understand that's a rule that needs to be looked at. And we will certainly do that and try to get that done as quickly as possible if they're if things have changed in the last 4 years in terms of that rule that may require a tweak here or there, whatever, we'll be happy to take a look at that. But I know that's an important rule, and we're going to get it done. We're going to support this industry because it's important. It's an important tool. It's an important value-added tool for farm income.
Thank you very much. And the other thing, food insecurity. You've heard about this all the country. I know the University of Vermont found that one Vermont households were food insecure in March and September 2020. We've done a number of things in our state to get food to people, including creation of the Farmers to Families Food Box Program, which fed a lot. Now, the last administration said they took that and they contracted in some of the strangest ways. They contracting vendors deliver food boxes. There are many times food boxes paid for a contract before never showed up. We do know that we have local vendors can work with local distributors and get local farmers and local food. And I want to get back to that. I know when we tried that in Vermont, we had somebody else have to go and said, no, we have to go out of state to do it. It costs a lot more money and didn't work as well. So please work with us, farmers to families, and make sure that there's going to be food assistance. At least we try, whatever state it is, to see if the food is available from local producers that helps the farmers. But it also gets the food quicker and usually cheaper to the families that need it.
That's a fair request, Senator, and it's also a way in which you can encourage local and regional food systems as a complement to our more commodity-based system. So happy to work with you on that and look for ways in which we can improve that program, especially as it relates to really remote areas that are serviced by it.
I know others are waiting, so I'll submit any other questions for the record, but I must say I'm delighted to have you back. You and I have worked very, very closely together in past years. I know Republicans and Democrats alike in the Senate have appreciated the fact that you've listened and been knowledgeable. And so after you visited your grandchildren, come and you can visit mine in Vermont. And just remember, there is a secret part of the Constitution, which is grandparents must spoil the grandchildren. My grandchildren believe in that part of the Constitution. So thank you very much, Mr. Secretary.
Well, thank you, Senator Leahy, former chairman. Thank you for all of your leadership over the years. Senator Grassley.
Thank you, Senator Stabenow. Congratulations once again to the secretary for being renominated for this position. In your previous position, you used the Commodity Credit Corporation for E15 and E85 pumps to help increase biofuel infrastructure. You probably don't know this, but in the CARES Act number one last March, we put $24.5 billion into it to help agriculture and food distribution for food supplement for lower income people, et cetera, et cetera. We tried to get the previous Secretary of Agriculture to use some of that money to help biofuels producers because we had just a lot of plants shut down or go into partial operation. So we made it very clear, since the previous secretary said he didn't think he had the authority to do it, in the recent CARES Act passed before Christmas, we included authority for the secretary to do that. So I'm hoping, if confirmed, or I guess maybe I should say I'm really asking you a question, would you be able to help us with this authority to utilize your authority to provide direct assistance to biofuel producers negatively impacted by COVID-19?
Senator, I'm aware of the fact that the industry didn't get the help that it needed, and certainly look for ways in which we can be assisting the industry. There's, in addition to what you mentioned, there's also the opportunity to take a look at the infrastructure program that Secretary Perdue did start. Not all of those resources, as I understand it, have been invested, so potentially there's a way that also could provide opportunities for us to help the industry at this point in time. So we will continue to look for ways to provide assistance because it's about strong markets for farmers and it's about jobs in rural areas.
Okay. Ensuring an affordable, safe, and stable supply of food is one of the most important jobs that you or any Secretary of Ag has. This past April, disruptions in beef production peaked when nearly 40% of the nation's beef processing capacity was idled, while the normal spread between boxed beef cutout value and fed cattle is around $21. Last April, the spread was over $279 per hundredweight, and the highest spread ever recorded. Because just four companies control over 80% of beef processing, the concentration of power in the industry led to beef shortages at grocery stores and producers out of luck to get bids on their animals. If you're confirmed, do you plan to reintroduce your fair market practices rule that you published the last week of the Obama administration? And I believe I was very supportive of what you were doing at that time, but then, you know, Trump came in and didn't move ahead with it. And so I hope that you'd be willing to go along that same line again.
Well, Senator, I think we will take a very close and detailed look at every tool that USDA has available to it to ensure more openness and more fairness and more transparency in our markets. And we'll also look for ways in which we can work collaboratively with the Department of Justice if there are issues relating to antitrust that need to be explored in greater detail. And we'll also take a look at ways in which we can provide incentives or resources that could potentially expand the amount of processing facilities in the country so that we're not faced with the disruption that we've seen in the past. We're not faced with market distortions that we've seen in the past, and we've not faced with farmers and ranchers believing that they're not getting a fair shake as we've seen in the past.
We continue to see large farms use loopholes to maximize crop insurance payments. I've long advocated for the responsible payment limitations on commodity programs and believe farmers should only receive payments if they're actually engaged on the farm and running the farm and working the farm. In 2020, the U.S. Department of Agriculture announced final rules on the definition of actively engaged in farming as part of the 2018 Farm Bill. This rule would have required additional family members to provide either 25% of the total management hours required or perform at least 500 hours of management each year. However, just weeks later, the USDA said that they made a mistake. It didn't apply to family-run operations. How would you define actively engaged as it relates to commodity program payments? Or put another way, so I really only have one question, how many hours does someone need to work to qualify for a farm payment? Now, that may be a difficult question for your ask, but it gives you a chance to tell me how you would approach this so that we don't have a lot of people that aren't really involved in farming to not get the help that only family farmers should get.
You know, Senator, I think this is a really important question. And the reason it's an important question is because so few people in this country farm, but people that you work with in the Congress and in the Senate may represent districts or may represent states that are less agricultural than a state of Iowa, like a state of Iowa. And so it becomes important for us to have programs that are legitimate, that are effective, efficient, and that are defensive. And it makes it more difficult for you to advocate on behalf of a proper safety net, proper risk management tools, if those tools are being abused, if they're being utilized in a way that provides help and assistance to people that might be practicing law in a high rise in some big city, as opposed to being on the ground in a tractor and a combine, as you often are. So my goal here would be to make sure that the programs that we have that provide that safety net are designed to help the people most in need of that help. The farmers on the ground, the people that are actually at risk financially, the folks that are sweating every single day in terms of markets, and not necessarily create a system that can be gamed. I don't know if that's a direct answer to your question, but I hope it gives you a sense of where my values are, where my focus will be. It's on helping farmers. It's not on helping people who may be part of a partnership or a limited partnership or a general partner structures that are set up to create avenues for people to take advantage of these programs. That doesn't help the program. It doesn't help you as an advocate for the program, and it doesn't help legitimize the appropriateness of a safety net for farmers.
Thank you very much. I yield.
Thank you very much. Senator Casey.
Thank you, Senator Stabenow, and I want to thank Secretary Vilsack for your continuing commitment to exemplary public service and your willingness to serve this administration and the American people. And of course, always proud of your Pennsylvania roots. I have two questions. We'll submit more for the record. I want to start with food security or food insecurity. And it's an issue that so many of us have worked on. I know you have in your work as secretary, but also want to thank you for the work that you did as Secretary of Agriculture, and of course, the work done by Senator Stabenow this year and others to provide more food assistance. We know the Biden administration has made clear they're committed to addressing food insecurity by providing more food assistance. The executive order to expand nutrition assistance was an important first step. But as you know, Mr. Secretary, there are significant additional investments that require congressional action, and that President Biden has called for in his American Rescue Plan. I appreciate the executive order, including direction for USDA to work with the Department of Justice to review its authority to allow states to provide extra SNAP emergency allotments to the lowest income households. As you know from our discussion, Pennsylvania's been unable to move forward with approved emergency allotments because the Department of Agriculture previously threatened to recoup more than $400 million in additional benefits. The relevant legal challenge was put on hold for 30 days, providing USDA an opportunity to examine and reconsider the decision made by the previous administration. First question, as Secretary, would you explore every legal option and opportunity to maximize emergency allotments to the states and provide much needed clarity to enable Pennsylvania and other states to move forward as quickly as possible?
Senator, I'm heartened by the fact that there are conversations taking place between the Department of Justice and the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania to try to get this resolved in a way that is appropriate and is acceptable to the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. I'd encourage those conversations. I hope that they ultimately end up at a place that you find satisfactory. We certainly encourage that conversation and appreciate the fact that there's still time to get this thing resolved in a way that makes sense. Let me just simply say, as a practical matter or as a philosophy, I think whatever we can do to provide as much help as we possibly can to people in need, we should do. I think however we can make those benefits most conveniently utilized, we should do. I think we should figure out additional ways to make qualification for access to these programs. I think in my conversations with Senator Bozeman, he talked about getting rid of the hassle that can sometimes be connected with these programs. I think he's absolutely right about that. I think there are ways that you could do this without minimizing the integrity or without disregarding the integrity of the programs. So if we can expand access, if we can increase benefits, if we can make them more convenient, I think more people will be helped. And I think that's what I would hope we would be able to do if I'm confirmed at USDA. That would be the goal. More access, more convenience. And I frankly think at some point in time, need to take a look at the level of benefit. It's great that it's been extended for 6 months, the 15% increase, but the reality is I think you'll find that the way in which we calculate that benefit doesn't make sense today. And if you create a benefit that's tied to the way things are today, just the need for an increase in the benefit.
Mr. Secretary, thank you for working with us on this issue. My last question is about water quality and climate change. We know that the same practices and programs that we worked to improve through the last Farm Bill for water quality also offer enormous climate benefits, as you know as well as anyone. We know the adoption of best management practices for water quality, like forested riparian buffers and filter strips, can also provide long-term carbon storage and emission reductions. The department has an important role to play in not only providing the financial and technical assistance, but also in terms of measuring and evaluating the benefits they provide. I've got a bill, the Farmer-Driven Conservation Outcomes Act, which would direct the department to establish a process through which USDA can measure, evaluate, and report on these conservation benefits. If confirmed, would you support efforts to stand up such measurement, evaluation, reporting systems at USDA to help us quantify the benefits of climate smart agriculture and water quality co-benefits?
Senator, if you want to have a functioning ecosystem market that supports water quality and encourages more investment in water quality, you need to be able to certify, measure, and quantify the results. So we'd be happy to work with you and anyone else who's interested in figuring out ways in which we can do a better job of that to make sure that those markets are as strong as they possibly can be. I'm convinced that it creates a new income opportunity for farmers, and we need to do everything we can to create those additional market opportunities.
Mr. Secretary, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Next, we have Senator Fisher. And just for everyone's knowledge, Senator Bozeman has stepped away to vote. When he's back, I will do that. He'll conclude the meeting, but we will be able to have everyone who wishes to be able to question Secretary Vilsack. So, Senator Fisher.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Secretary Vilsack, I know that my colleague, Senator Hoven, touched on this a bit, and I appreciate your comments on the need for additional slaughtering capacity. But are you concerned that negotiated trade levels in the Fed cattle market may have diminished to the point that price discovery is not sufficient to enable the cow-calf and cattle feeding segments to benefit from our current market conditions?
The quick answer to that is yes. I think we need more price discovery, Senator.
Do you have you thought about different ideas on how that can be achieved? Because I just may have a bill for you.
Well, I'm happy to work with you, and I'm sure that you've got very good ideas, given the important role that that industry plays in Nebraska. I'm not surprised that you have some ideas, and would look forward to, if confirmed, working with you to figure out what works best for Nebraska and for the country.
Great, thank you. I enjoyed our conversation that we had before this hearing earlier a couple weeks ago, and I do appreciate your interest in that. As you know, the U.S. is a global leader in the production of high-quality, sustainable beef because cattle producers worked hard for decades to improve the quality of our cattle and build the brand that consumers love and trust. I think there is a general agreement that the USDA's generically approved product of the USA label has failed to keep up with evolving consumer expectations. Many are of the mindset that USDA already has the necessary tools and regulatory power to improve this dated generic label. Do you believe that the current labeling policy adequately informs consumers?
If it's the same policy as it was 4 years ago when I left, the answer is no. We made every concerted effort to try to create better transparency, better information for consumers, because we understand and appreciate that consumers want to know where their food comes from. They want to know when they're buying U.S. or when they're not buying, when they're buying from someplace else. We attempted on three occasions to sort of strengthen the country of origin labeling unsuccessfully because the WTO challenges by our Canadian friends, which would have resulted obviously in retaliation. I am absolutely willing to listen to anybody and everybody who's got an idea about how we can circumvent or how we can get to a point where the WTO doesn't necessarily slap it down that creates retaliatory impacts on American agriculture. I'm frank to say I need help in that respect. We can ignore the WTO, but then we got the retaliation, and then you know that's just right. Not a good situation. So
that wouldn't be a good thing. I hope that we can work together and bring in a lot of stakeholders from the cattle industry to be able to look at that and possibly look at what the USDA can already do. You know, that maybe the tools, as I said earlier, maybe the tools are already there. Maybe we can strengthen that product of the USA labeling so it will work and be accepted by our trading partners so that we don't have to face sanctions then in the future as well.
I'm happy to do that, Senator.
Wonderful. Thank you. As you know, Nebraska is the perfect agricultural laboratory for creating a data-driven farm of the future. With our seven climate zones and wide variation in soils and precipitation, we've been leaders on precision livestock and crop production. Would you expand on how innovations in agriculture will drive precision livestock and crop production and continue our nation's global leadership role in feeding and fueling the world?
Well, happy to do that. Whether it's our consumers here in the U.S. or our efforts to try to export overseas, I can tell you we are facing competition on not just the quality, not just the safety, not just the taste, not just the price. We're also now facing competition on whether or not whatever it is we're selling has been sustainably produced. So to the extent that we can make the case to the world that what's being raised, what's being grown, what's being sold outside the U.S. is being raised and grown in the most sustainable, animal-friendly environments, we can make the case and provide a market advantage to the U.S. So innovation becomes critically important. The President Obama, President Biden has a vision of a zero emission agriculture. And I will tell you, if we reach that vision by 2050, the goal that he set, as we're reaching it, it will give us an incredible competitive advantage in the world markets because people are hungry for this. But we won't be able to do this without innovation. We won't be able to do it without precision agriculture. We won't be able to do it without a true commitment to soil health and regenerative practices. We won't be able to do it without organic playing a role. We won't be able to do it without a technology that converts agricultural waste into a variety of products so that we move away from an extraction economy we've had in the past to a more circular or more regenerative economy. That's the goal. And if we do that, Senator, I guarantee you we will be able to sell our product anywhere in the world. If we don't do it, we're going to have trouble selling it anywhere in the world.
How important is our role of our land-grant universities in all of this in trying to complement the efforts of the USDA?
Well, it's funny you mentioned that land-grant. This is a 1863 report of the Commission of Agriculture. It was part of the Interior Department. It's the first report from the Commissioner of Agriculture to Abraham Lincoln. If you read the preface of that document, 600 pages about agriculture in the United States, you would be surprised how much similarity there is between that period of time in 1863 and now, and the critical role that education, the land-grant university system that was launched in 1862, and the need for research and innovation has in providing more profitability, more opportunity for farmers, ranchers, producers, and people who live in rural America. It's just the land-grant university is one of the great gifts that President Lincoln and succeeding generations have provided to this country, and it has an important role. I think it has an essential role. And it's not just the 1862s, it's also the minority-serving institutions that also have that role in making sure that information gets out to the country. And I would hope that the USDA could work collaboratively, and I believe it would, if I'm confirmed, would work collaboratively with that land-grant university system. I've spent the last 4 years affiliated with Colorado State University, and as a governor, I had a very keen understanding of Iowa State University. So I can tell you that it's a tremendous, tremendous treasure, and we need to utilize it, and we need to invest in it across the board. And if we don't, we're not going to have the innovation that we need to be competitive.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate your being here today and your clear answers. Thank you, sir.
Senator Smith.
Thank you very much, Chair Bozeman. And Secretary Vilsack, it's great to see you again. I will give you a chance to take a sip of your tea or coffee because you've had a long morning so far. I so appreciated the chance to visit with you a couple of weeks ago, and I really appreciate, as a fellow Minnesotan, your understanding of the diversity of agriculture in our part of the country and the importance of family farmers and ranchers. And I really liked also the way you framed up your comments today, this morning, in terms of four what-if moments around climate and food security and competition and inequity. And we've had a lot of good, great conversation about climate and biofuels, so I want to just associate myself with those good questions from Senator Klobuchar and others. I'd actually like today to hone in a little bit on this question of inequity, and especially what USDA can do to expand access to resources, especially access to credit. So, you know, I'm sure you know in Minnesota, we have Hmong refugees that brought their farming traditions to Minnesota in the 1970s. We have a significant community of Latino farmers that are really integral to our ag sector, led by great organizations like the Latino Economic Development Center. And we also have Native farmers that are really central to our history and are, as they work to diversify their economies, are working hard to find markets for their unique products like wild rice, which is becoming a very prized product overseas. So in the 2018 Farm Bill, I pushed for provisions that would help to evaluate access to credit and how well diverse farmers, farmers of color, have access to credit as they work to build their family businesses. And the study came out, they did that, the study came out in 2019, and it found that traditionally underserved farming communities face really significant barriers to receiving private agricultural credit, and that traditionally underserved communities are often not even aware of what their credit options and lending options are. So in the spirit of your opening comments, could you just expand a little bit on how you see this and what you think the USDA can do internally and externally to ensure that these communities are aware of and have true and full access to credit options as they try to operate their farms?
There are multiple steps that need to be taken, Senator. First of all, I think we need to take a much deeper dive than has ever been taken before in terms of the USDA programs to identify what barriers actually in fact exist in each of those programs. And I would anticipate and expect that we would put together, for lack of a better term, an equity commission or a task force that would be charged with taking a look at USDA programs, identifying, is there systemic racism inherent to these programs? Are there barriers, maybe intentional or unintentional barriers, that make it difficult for people to access the programs? And if so, how do we correct that? What steps need to be taken? Number one. Number two, I think it's about technical assistance and making sure that we work with people who are trusted in the community. It's very difficult sometimes in those communities to go in from the government and say, you know, the old adage, we're from the government, we're here to help. Maybe it's better to say, we're from the government, we want to affiliate ourselves with a community building organization that you do trust, that you do listen to. And then we want to work with that community building organization to provide the information and the technical assistance and the awareness and the steps necessary for you to be successful in developing these programs. Then it takes a workforce that's diverse, that has the right perspective. Maybe some of the people themselves have been through this, so that you essentially have people that are sympathetic and understanding, that maybe the rules may not be fully understood. It may take a little time. It may take some patience to get it done. And then to the extent we have an appeal process, that appeal process has to be true, has to be a real appeal process. It can't be a whitewash, if you will. What we need is to make sure that we have people on those appeal boards at the county level and at the state level that also represent that diversity. And when I was secretary before, I exercised the power to enhance the diversity in many of those county committees. Obviously willing to do that again, but what the hope would be that folks locally understand and appreciate the necessity of having that voice, that person in the room that can explain why this appeal should be considered. Mm-hmm. And also, I would say it's also accountability. And making sure that I, if I'm confirmed as secretary, and the undersecretaries and the people who are responsible for administering these programs are held accountable. So that means collecting information and data to make sure that we are aware if there's a problem, where the problem might be, so we can address it as quickly as possible. Those are some of the steps that need to be taken, I believe.
I really appreciate your answer, and I appreciate especially your what you say about listening to the people that are on the ground. I think about in Minnesota, where we've got the Hmong American Farmers Association and the Latino Economic Development Corporation that know so much about what their members and their community need to make this work. And I'll also just point out that the Minneapolis Fed has also just recently released some data about underserved communities in Minnesota and have a really excellent Center for Indian Country Development that could be really helpful here. So I would love to invite you to Minnesota to have conversations with some of these really talented and knowledgeable community members. I bet Senator Klobuchar would be interested in this as well. I know she is, and I think we could do some real good here and strengthen the ag economy as well as create more opportunities for family farmers. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Senator Braun.
Thank you, Senator Bozeman. Secretary Vilsack, enjoyed our conversation last week. We covered several topics, and I'm going to focus on three of them, two with some time, and start off with talking about farmers as being great stewards of the land. And I've been involved in the conservation side of farming and involved in farming for decades. And the one thing I see each year that's tougher for farmers is the stakes go up, the risk is greater financially. I hearken back to 09 to 13, the last time until just recently we had decent profits in especially the grain markets, which have a ripple effect through poultry, livestock, and so forth. You know, mentioning anything you can do that's going to make life less complicated for farmers, if we're going to keep family farms as the grassroots level of how we produce food in this country, I think there are a lot of things that need to kind of work in the right direction. I am glad that you're interested in, and I think there's benefits to be derived, adding profit per acre by taking the good stewardship that most farmers exercise anyway, matching it up with voluntary markets. I'm involved in a bill to do that. I think that'll happen, hopefully maybe this year. I want to focus on what since 09 and 13, and that was right after, I guess, the days of LDPs and direct payments, which we'll get to the second thing I'm going to talk about here in a moment, the heavy involvement of government over the years that we've just weaned ourselves away from. Part of the solution in my mind is to look at when you, the inputs that they use in their business have doubled, tripled, and sometimes quadrupled between 09 and 13 and the present. And I think market concentration is something that whenever you have too much of it, we see it in healthcare now, we see it in tech, we see it in many other places, inputs, prices, costs go up, stay up, don't come down. Would you comment on what you would do in your unique position to address the things that farmers need to buy and purchase increasingly from fewer and fewer and less local all the time in terms of the major inputs that go into their business?
Senator, I think one of the things that we could do and should do is for the Secretary of Agriculture to reach out to the Attorney General and see whether or not the Attorney General and Department of Justice would be interested in reinvigorating, recreating the task force that that occurred a number of years ago with the express understanding of taking a look, a very deep dive into the issues that you've raised, and perhaps expanding that task force beyond the Department of Justice to include other players that may have an impact, whether it's you know, the Federal Trade Commission or whether it's the Small Business Administration or whoever might have an equity, if you will, in this issue of markets that are working, markets that are competitive, markets that are open. I think there are tools, obviously, within the USDA that we need to take a look at relative to examining the economic analysis and deep data of the impact of concentration on the costs, on the input costs, to create sort of a foundation, a basis for potential action and rulemaking if necessary. I think you and I talked about the patent laws, whether or not that they need to be looked at and examined to determine whether or not in a day of rapid and incredibly rapid change, they need to be looked at in terms of the amount of time that folks have in terms of patent protection. And I think, frankly, we need to research. This is a bit of field from the input question you asked, but I think we need to take a look at how we might be able to significantly increase public research so that the foundation research upon which new seeds and so forth can be developed isn't necessarily as expensive as our current system where the private sector basically creates the new technology and then licenses it to seed companies. So I think there are a multitude of ways in which the USDA can be engaged in this conversation.
You know, in times like these where agriculture has been stressed so often, in my 2 years here, any industry that gets in trouble generally comes to the federal government to look for help. And I think most farmers, as I mentioned earlier, were glad to wean themselves from LDP payments, direct payments, and basically most of the involvement, other than in a year like going through COVID, would have been through crop insurance. Couple things. Government can cost farmers per acre with burdensome regulations. Again, I believe in conservation. I believe in saving the resource, treating it well. Waters of the U.S. Had a significant impact on farmers and developers in terms of, I think, adding undue burdens. And I would hope that you look at that side of the equation, too, because I think you'll be in a unique position to weigh in. Regulation where you need it, make sure it's not in overdrive. And then try to keep focus on maybe helping find new markets, do things that are going to broaden the ability for farmers to sell what they produce, and keeping costs down, which you mentioned a little bit ago, and then mostly avoiding government ending up getting more involved, because I think that is one thing that, first of all, from a budget point of view, we cannot take on the burden of doing more when we're running trillion-dollar deficits structurally. I would just like your comment on how we keep farmers healthy without, you know, reverting to the federal government being more involved in a financial way.
Well, I think, in a word, markets. The ability to create more local and regional markets, the ability to create new markets with our emphasis on climate, the ability to expand on our export activities, either by virtue of newer markets or by more competitive opportunities in existing markets. So it starts with markets, Senator. I think that's critically important. And I do believe that we are on the cusp of creating a series of new market opportunities that will provide greater resiliency in the system, that will provide more income opportunities for farmers, that will be right, do right by the environment, and I think will create jobs in rural places. I think we need to seize this moment. If confirmed, I would hope that I could work with you and others in the committee to make that day happen. I think the president's got the right vision of a zero emission agriculture. I do believe, honestly, that it will create enormous new opportunities and allow that family farm, regardless of size, to stay in business and to be able to pass it on to the next generation, which is what I think most farmers are anxious to do.
Thank you. Do look forward to working with you on those three topics and others as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Gillibrand.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Vilsack, welcome again to this hearing. I consider you a part native New Yorker, having gone to school at Hamilton and Albany Law. And I hope that you will come and visit New York State as Agriculture Secretary again. I think it would be very meaningful to a lot of our producers. One of the issues I want to touch upon is dairy. You know that New York is the number third producing state for dairy in the country. But during this pandemic, and even over the last 10 years, dairies, especially small family-owned dairies, have continued to dwindle. And we've seen such extreme hardships that we've seen bankruptcies and suicides in the dairy industry. And so it is a vital interest of mine that we talk about how we can reform dairy pricing. You obviously headed a large dairy organization since 2017. And mid and small sized dairy farms will need to know that you will also be able to look out for them. What assurances can you give these dairies? And can you please elaborate specifically on how you intend to help them?
Senator, I think first and foremost, we talked a little bit about the local and regional food system. I think there are terrific opportunities for small and mid sized dairy operations to take advantage of being able to sell locally, to be able to negotiate prices, to be able to also potentially get assistance and help from the USDA to create small processing facilities where they can convert their product into something more value added instead of shipping it to a processing facility where it's value added someplace else. Mm-hmm. There are examples of that. I think there are ways in which we can provide help and assistance. I think there are ways in which we can encourage from farm to school. You know, obviously, there are, in addition to fluid milk products, there are other products that could potentially be purchased by a school that's being locally produced, and creating more market opportunities. That's one. Two, I think what's interesting, you mentioned the milk marketing system, very complicated, very confusing, very difficult to understand. But one of potentially a number of issues that you could raise about that is that it doesn't take into consideration the value that comes from exports. And more milk is in fact being, if you will, exported in the form of powder and cheese and so forth around the world. One out of every six tankers of milk actually gets exported. The value of that's not factored into the price that goes to it, and it needs to be. And I don't, you know, I think that there are ways in which we can work together to make sure that that process, as it unfolds, provides a better price for the farmers, a fairer price that takes in consideration all that's being currently done with
Yeah, but I think it also needs to actually take into account the cost of production and what that is regionally, because many times the reimbursement rate is below the cost of production, and different parts of the country have different costs of production. And we don't want agriculture for any one fruit, vegetable, dairy product to be regionalized, because we know that ag should always be looked in a national security lens when trace elements of nuclear fallout material was found in dairies in California. That raised huge alarm because of a nuclear fallout incident in Japan. So we want to make sure that we don't lose areas of the country that are committed to production because our formulas don't work for everybody. So I would just urge you to work with me on a really fulsome review of how that milk pricing takes place. The second issue I'd like to talk about is nutrition. Obviously, the pandemic has left millions of families without a source of income, and many have turned to federal programs like WIC and SNAP for the first time, along with pandemic EBT. The USDA has given many flexibilities and waivers to states to operate these programs efficiently through the pandemic, making it easier for Americans to apply for those benefits and getting more families to be able to feed their hungry kids. But clearly much more needs to be done. So I want to show what actions you will take as secretary to support these programs to further alleviate the strain. And can you speak to the importance of the PEBT program? And do you believe that Congress should permanently authorize this program?
Senator, one of the first things we need to be able to do is to provide the resources that you all voted on and provided for states to be distributed. I think it's $100 million of assistance to encourage more help at the state level. A lot of the implementation of these programs occurs at the state level, so I think it's important for us to provide the resources so that the states can do a better job, provide clarity and flexibility so states can do a better job. And I think the Secretary of Agriculture needs to work very, very directly with governors to make sure that it is a priority of every single governor, because frankly, sometimes it's not. Sometimes they leave it up to their human services folks to take care of these programs. They need to be engaged personally to make sure that folks understand it is a priority that these nutrition assistance programs are available to people, they're accessible to people, they're easily qualified for folks, and that the benefits are get to them. Secondly, well,
keep going.
Secondly, the reality is we need to figure out ways in which these benefits can be conveniently used, especially in the face of a pandemic. I mean, it's all well and good to give somebody a SNAP card and say, go to your local grocery store and buy more food. That's great, assuming you have a grocery store. But if you don't have a grocery store, then what? And are there ways in which, with the online work of restaurants that are closed, is there a way of incorporating them in an effort to get resources and food? How do we bolster the capacity of food banks and pantries by investing in their infrastructure? I mean, they are a significant asset here. They are underutilized because they don't have the capacity to store or refrigerate. I mean, there are a multitude of ways in which we need to work at USDA to make this system much more robust and more resilient. You mentioned
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Just to put my time is up, and I want to just tell you, I have two questions I'm adding to the record for you to answer in your free time. One is about related to food stamps and other programs is about nutrition. And the second one is about the food supply chain. We've had horrible disruption because of COVID. So I'll submit those for the record so I don't abuse my time and take too much. So thank you, Mr. Secretary. And you can also finish your, or Mr. Soon-to-be Secretary, you can finish your answer on that also in writing. Thank you.
Senator Thun. Okay, Senator Thun is having technical problems. Are we going to resolve those, or are we going to burn him? Okay, he's not on. I know the secretary will be glad to take Senator Thun's call if he's got some questions he would like to ask. Senator Vilsack, thank you so much for your willingness to be considered for service to agriculture and rural America as Secretary of Agriculture. This committee has a history of working in a bipartisan fashion while crafting legislation and considering nominations. And in that spirit, Secretary Vilsack has agreed to expedite his responses to committee members' questions for the record. As a result of that, as a result of his cooperation in the Senate's committee, our committee cooperation, as a result, later today we will hold a business meeting in conjunction with floor votes at a site off the floor of the Senate. The purpose of the business meeting will be to consider the nomination of Senator Vilsack. Normally that's done 48 hours later, but again, because of the circumstances and because of we were able to agree to do that, we're going to do this as quickly as possible. So I'm going to yield to Senator Thun, who has solved his technical problems. You thought you were off the hook, Secretary Vilsack, but you've got one more. Senator Thun. We're working on it. Are you there, Senator Thun? Can you hear us? These are the trials.
Got in just 1 second.
Trials and tribulations of COVID times. Okay, well, again, as I said earlier, I know Senator Secretary Vilsack that you're quite willing and able and want to talk to follow up with Senator Thun, so that shouldn't be a problem at all. I ask members to submit any additional questions you may have for the record by 5 o'clock p.m. today, Tuesday, February 2nd, and the nominee has agreed to respond promptly and completely. In addition, the record will remain open for 5 business days for members to submit a statement or additional materials. Again, thank everybody today for your time today. And
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Senator Thun.
Can I get in very quickly here?
No, you can jump in, and then as soon as you're done, we'll just bang the gavel and we'll be out of here.
All right, my apologies. I was juggling multiple meetings.
We understand.
Let me just very quickly, Secretary Vilsack, thank you for your willingness to serve again, and welcome back to the Senate Ag Committee. Let me just touch on a couple of things that I've talked to you about already, but that I would like to have you speak to on the record, and some of it's been covered by some of my colleagues. But one of them has to do with volatility in the cattle market, and integrity in that market. There's a lot of concerns out there about potential manipulation, market manipulation, and lack of competition among meat packers. And as Senator Grassley pointed out, there are four packers who have 80% of the processing capacity in the country. I'd like to get your thoughts on, if confirmed, what actions you would take to strengthen the integrity of the cattle market, your views on packers and stockyards, and what ideas you might have to address the consolidation issue. I know I'm getting a lot of questions into one there. And then if you could segue into country of origin labeling, an issue which has already, again, been covered, but one that continues to be an incredibly important issue to many producers in South Dakota. Your views on the COOL rulings, if confirmed, you know, whether you'd be willing to work with us on a, and my staff on finding a path forward, preferably a WTO compliant path on COOL to help address the concerns of South Dakota producers. So that's a lot in one question, but if you could just kind of give us your views on that, and if we don't get to cover it all, I can cover it, follow up with a question for the record.
Senator, happy, I'll sort of work in reverse, happy to work with you and your staff on anything that would allow us to advance a country of origin labeling. As you know, we tried, WTO basically suggested that we hadn't succeeded. If there's a way to get it to be WTO compliant, I would be more than happy to work with you and look forward to that. Packers and stockyards, look, we're gonna look at every vehicle that we have, every capacity we have with the USDA to make sure that we have open, fair, and transparent markets, where we have appropriate price discovery, where we have the data and the economic analysis that allows us to determine whether or not there's a problem in the market, and if there is, using the tools that we have to try to provide greater competition, greater openness, greater transparency, greater fairness. I think there are ways in which we could also expand significantly processing opportunities in this country so that we're not overly reliant on a small number of processors. I think we saw the penalty of that, if you will, during COVID. It's not the last time we're going to have COVID type situations and major disruptions. We need to make sure we are prepared to make the system more resilient, and that means having more capacity. And I would also look to work closely with the Department of Justice to determine whether or not they see reasons for additional action on their behalf, and we'll certainly work collaboratively with them. I suggested the opportunity for the recreation of the task force that was established some time ago, potentially expanding the membership of that task force in a way that would give us the best opportunity to evaluate. These are not easy cases. They're not easy issues to resolve, but I think there are a multitude of things that we can take and steps we can take to help producers have greater confidence in the market.
Well, we look forward to working with you on those because there is a lot of skepticism out there right now that sort of an actual free market exists. And so we continue to work with you. Let me ask a quick question here. The President Biden and some of the other cabinet noms have not been shy about their desire to invest heavily in electric vehicles and EVs. We believe biofuels like ethanol and biodiesel can achieve significant near-term greenhouse gas reductions using the existing consumer fleet, vehicle fleet, and a majority of the existing fueling infrastructure. There was a recent Harvard study that found that the average greenhouse gas reduction of ethanol over gasoline is 46%, with some producers achieving as high as 61% life cycle reductions. If confirmed, how will you help leverage the farm economy and biofuels as part of the administration's climate agenda, and more specifically, how will you provide parity, or I should say, will you provide parity for biofuel blending infrastructure with respect to EV funding?
Senator, going to look for ways in which we can encourage and incent and continue to support the biofuel industry, whether it's utilizing the existing program that Secretary Perdue established on getting those resources out the door, whether it's taking a look at the COVID relief packages and determining whether or not there are ways in which the industry can be helped today for the difficulties they've experienced during COVID, or whether it's directly working with my colleagues at EPA to make sure that the renewable fuel standard is followed, that we don't grant waivers liberally to entities that don't need them, so that we continue to have a market. I think we can make the case, should make the case, and will make the case that there is a role to play for biofuels in climate, in reduction of emissions. I think there's a role for the biofuel industry to play as it relates to marine and aviation fuel as well. I think there's a terrific opportunity there. And I think there's a role for the biofuel industry to play in terms of fleet maintenance. We're not going to convert. There won't be enough electric vehicles to convert all of that fleet in a relatively short period of time. It's obviously there's going to be a fairly significant transition. I mentioned earlier that I'm the owner of a 2006 Ford Focus. I don't think I'm any different than a lot of Americans. They're going to continue to maintain and own those cars. GM, Ford, they're going to continue to make those cars. So we have to have a fuel system that supplies those cars. And if it's going to, and we might as well have a biofuel system that supplies those cars, because it's about jobs, it's about income stability for farmers, it's about better environmental, and it's about more competition for your transportation dollar, and consumers benefit, and reduce our reliance on fossil fuels. So I think there are a lot of reasons why this administration and future administrations will continue to be investing in the biofuel industry.
Okay, thank you. Again, you're hitting all the right themes there, and I look forward to working with you on that issue. And I know, Mr. Chairman, my time has expired. I appreciate your indulgence. I have a couple of questions I'd like to perhaps submit for the record, but Mr. Secretary, thank you for being with us today, and we will look forward to engaging you on this and other issues that impact the economy and farm and ranch country. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Senator Thune. And with that, I want to thank everyone for their time today. And I believe that we will have the confirmation vote between votes at 2:30. That's my understanding. Okay. So we look forward to that. And with that, we're adjourned.